الحمد لله الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين سيدنا ونبينا ومولانا محمد صلى الله تعالى عليه وسلم وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. The relationship between ulama and umara. Ulama, the men of learning. Umara, those who hold power in politics. MashaAllah, in Arabic it rhymes. Has always been one of mixed feelings, ambivalent we normally say. On the one hand, the ulama have provided religious legitimation for those in power. Truly, you can see in the world what is happening. And on the other hand, there is also a general awareness that power corrupts those that are in power and compromises the ulama's moral authority and the integrity of their learning. We have seen this throughout the world, we have seen this throughout the centuries. There's a well-known hadith often quoted by the ulama, and it says, the worst among the ulama are those who go see the umara, while the best among the umara are those who come and see the ulama. This hadith has actually been pointed out that it is da'if, not fabricated, but da'if, it is weak. But it has also been pointed out that the excessive amount of this hadith has been used by the ulama, it stresses a point of concern and strong feelings that the ulama have, that under no circumstances that should the ulama try to curry favor with those that are in power politically, because otherwise you'll be bought over. You know the old saying that I say, I can resist everything except temptation. You know, and how true. How many times have you seen ulama have fallen by the wayside because of the political clout? Of, wasn't there a person now in the Shabib Sheikh case, for example, you know, when he was convicted? And on TV you will find a lot of ulama are there to support or stand by him or whatever it is. That is, it's terrible. Even if it is family, you don't put yourself in the picture to show yourself, you know, mashallah, I support you, my dear brother. You know, you've made, you must ask Allah, astaghfar, and so forth. Be careful. One has to be very, very careful how we align ourselves when it comes to this. The honor that the ulama have been given, subhanAllah, is so beautifully expressed by Kathir bin Qais. He says, I was one day sitting in the company of Abu Darda radiallahu anhu in the Masjid of Damascus. And he says, a man comes to him and he says, I have heard that you narrated a hadith from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he said, Abu Darda says, did you come here for trade? And the man says, no. Did you come here for anything else? The man says, no. I have come for the purpose just to listen for a hadith. And he traveled all the way from Medina to Munawwara to Damascus just for a hadith. These were the way the former ulama really traveled in search. And I'll speak a little bit further. So, and Abu Darda is now relating this hadith, and he says, "Man salaka tariqan yaltamisu fihi ilman," whoever follows a path in pursuit of knowledge, "sahalallahu tariqan ila al-jannah," Allah will make easy for him a path towards paradise and Jannah. Allah make us of those, ya Allah. وَإِنَّ الْمَلَائِكَةَ, he says, and the malaika lower their wings in approval of the seeker of knowledge. وَإِنْ طَالِبَ الْعِلْمِ And for the seeker of knowledge, the talib, the student, everyone in the heavens and earth prays for the forgiveness of the talib. Subhanallah. Hatta al-hitan fil ma, until even the fish in the sea asks for forgiveness for you. Isn't that amazing? Subhanallah. And the hadith goes further. The superiority of the scholar over the worshipper is like the superiority of the moon over all the heavenly bodies. Inna al-ulama, verily the scholars are the heirs of the prophets. For the prophets did not leave behind dinaran wala dirhaman. They did not leave behind a dinar or dirhams. Rather, they left behind knowledge. So whoever takes it, finds it, has taken a great share. May Allah make us of those who are unapologetic. We know that the ulama cannot inherit in prophethood, but they inherit what they have left behind. And it is for us to pick up the pearls and the wisdom behind them. When Fudail ibn Iyad, rahimahullah, heard this hadith, al-ulama warathatul anbiya, that the scholars are the inheritors of the prophets. So he says, I heard a man say that to Fudail ibn Iyad, the ulama are the inheritors of the prophets. And Iyad answers, he says, Al-hukama warathatul anbiya. Subhanallah. He says, the people of wisdom, hikmah, they are the ones who are the inheritors of the knowledge of the Prophet. So the man retorts and says, but the ulama are many. Fudail answers, but the hukama are very few and little. Subhanallah. This hadith is corroborated by the ayat of the Quran, where Allah Jalla Jalaluhu says, ثُمَّ أَوْرَثْنَا الْكِتَابَ الَّذِينَ اصْطَفَيْنَا مِنْ عِبَادِنَا. Then we cause to inherit the book those who we have chosen of our servants. فَمِنْهُمْ ظَالِمٌ لِنَفْسِهِ. And among them is he who wrongs himself. وَمِنْهُمْ مُقْتَصِدٌ. And among them is he who is moderate. وَمِنْهُمْ سَابِقُ الْخَيْرَاتِ بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ. And among them is he who is foremost in good deeds by the permission of Allah. ذَلِكَ هُوَ الْفَضْلُ الْكَبِيرُ. And that inheritance is the great ni'mah or bounty that one can receive. Again, may Allah make us of those, ya Allah. The knowledge possessed by these scholars is a knowledge deemed to be ilmun nafi', beneficial knowledge. And Imam Ghazali, rahimahullah, he says, he defines that knowledge. He says, knowledge of the way to Allah, and it is the knowledge in the next life, about the next life. So when we learn knowledge, my dear brothers and sisters and elders, it is not only about information, it is the transformation of oneself inwardly and outwardly. That is what ilm is. That's the one, subhanAllah. This deep understanding that Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam speaks about in deen. Man yuridallahu bihi khayran, whomever Allah wishes well, yufaqbihu fi deen. Allah gives that person a deep understanding of the deen. May Allah make us of those, ya Allah. This deep understanding, Imam Abu Hanifa, rahimahullah, he says, fiqh is to know oneself, what it is for, is it for you or if it is against you. This deep understanding of religion encompasses all three dimensions of religion. It believes, which is iman, as we know in Hadith Jibreel, also the outward actions, which we say Islam, we know Islam wa ala khams, you know, we understand external aspects, salah, zakah, fasting, and so forth. And the most important one is ihsan. In other words, spiritual excellence is what we are after. Many of us today, unfortunately, We find ourselves, some, many, I don't know what the figures are, they do not respect the alims anymore. And part of the blame are the alims themselves. They have created this. But that gives one no cause or reason, especially just to apply blanket and show disrespect. And we see it now on social media. Ya Allah. Just because you become Mufti Google and you found something on Google or whatever, and then you suddenly blast the ulama when they have been sitting at the feet of their teachers and ustaz for years, even if it's just for a month. But the fact that you sit by an ustaz and learn by that person's feet, subhanAllah, what goes between heart and heart, what goes between eyes and eyes, this is different. What you see in Mufti Google, you just see a reflection of yourself. That is what is actually happening. So be very careful, dear brothers and sisters and elders. Allah actually warns us and tells us, قُلْ هَلْ يَسْتَوِي الَّذِينَ يَعْلَمُونَ وَالَّذِينَ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ Tell them, Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, are they equal, those who have knowledge and those who do not have? إِنَّمَا يَتَذَكَّرُ أُولُو الْأَلْبَابِ But only men of understanding, of fikr and dhikr, they will understand and they will take this admonition. The Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said, no, la, do not refute an alim and do not go against him and do not hate him, but instead love him. For surely loving them is sincerity and hating them is hypocrisy. The Prophet also says, whoever insults an alim is as if he has insulted me. And whoever insults me is as if he has insulted Allah. And whoever insults Allah, then his path is eternal hell. Whoever, however, says Nabi alayhi salam, honors an alim, it is as if he has honored me. And whoever honors me is as if he has honored Allah. And whoever honors Allah, then his path is towards paradise. Subhanallah. The reality today, unfortunately, we see today that some of the ulama, because of the paucity in knowledge, in strength, whether it be secular or whatever, they do not have the courage or the knowledge to face the issues and address it to the people and give them nasiha. That is the one sad side of it. Some of it is probably due to some of the institutions that they come out of. You know, and I always say, you can't teach people if you don't do it. If you don't make salah, you're going to go to Jahannam. Rather tell them, my dear brother, my sister, if you make salah, you'll go to Jannah. It's exactly the same. But the way you are saying, and you know my old cliche, is to do with hikmah, with wisdom. As I always say, knowledge is to know that tomato is a tomato is a fruit. But wisdom is to know not to put tomato in. Fruit salad, mashallah. That is how one applies knowledge. Go to Jahannam. Is the Prophet ever speak to people like that? Wallahi, you are Rasul. There is a Jahannami. Astaghfirullah. He is to embrace them, encourage them. Even the person who was urinating in the masjid, what did the Prophet say? Go fetch a couple of buckets of water and just sprinkle over it. You know, when a person is uncouth, I mean, hate is tiny, man. You understand? You come from the desert. What did you expect further? And unfortunately, we're supposed to be very cool and very cool in this part of the world with all the knowledge. I think we are peeing in the masjid the way we are carrying on. Astaghfirullah. May Allah protect us, Ya Allah. Nabi alayhi salam says about corruption, especially amongst the ulama. He said, two types of people who, if they are righteous, the people are righteous. And if they are bad, the people are bad. And who are they? They are the scholars and they are the rulers. And then other hadith we have heard. We deserve the rulers that are upon us because of our own actions. So do self-introspection first. Why is this thing going like this throughout the world, for example? Why is it happening in my family? What am I doing wrong? Look at that. Don't look for excuses there. By pointing, you got four fingers pointing back at you. It's so important that we have to identify. Nabi alayhi salam says, do not ask me about evil, but ask me about good. And he says this three times. And he says again, the worst of evil is the evil scholars. And the best of good are the good scholars. Subhanallah. If you look at the ulama of the past, you couldn't corrupt them. You couldn't buy them. Nothing you could do. And a few examples I want to give to you. Subhanallah. Part of the problem today that we have is because some of the ulama are so underpaid that they are forced to go look for a second and a third job. Ya Allah. To such a degree that they even have to steal. How many times haven't we seen this happening in our community? MashaAllah, and this is no reflection on this masjid. They look well off that. May Allah bless them, subhanAllah. If you look at some of the ulama, Imam Abu Hanifa, for example, subhanAllah, the founder of the Hanafi madhab, he was summoned by Mansur, the Khalifa at the time of the Islamic Empire. And he was asked to take the position of Qadi, the judge. And he refused. Because he knew the Khalifa was corrupt. Now you look favors. You look, isn't it happening in Egypt? Isn't some of the countries suddenly being bought over? Some of the ulama are being bought over? And you suddenly find a fatwa being issued which is in favor of the rulers? It happened in the history of India as well. So one has to be very careful. So Imam Abu Hanifa refuses. And Mansur, he became outraged. You know? And he says, this is Imam Abu Hanifa, he says, I am not fit for this position. And Mansur says, you lie, you are fit for the position. Imam Abu Hanifa says, if I am lying, then I can't be a judge. And if I am telling the truth, I can still not be the judge. Ya Allah, look at him. As a result, what happened to him? He was lashed, he was thrashed, but he refused to compromise his principles. This was Imam Abu Hanifa. Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, Ma'mun, became Khalifa, and he adopted the Mu'tazilite belief. That's another topic by itself. That the Quran was created, and you know, all these kind of things, and Allah had a hand, when Allah speaks of it. We have crazy aqidah in our Islamic belief, different types of isms that we have. But, so, he refused, Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, he refused to accept his leadership. So his uncle says, you know what, accept it by your mouth, man, but in your heart, you know. Wist u gefreed in other words, really. So, the alim Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal says, if the alim stays silent in the face of falsehood, when will the truth become manifest? Really? Subhanallah. So he preferred prison, was thrown into prison. These were the great giants of those, some of us who might be even sitting here, Allah forbid you not, that you say, ah, who is Imam Abu Hanifa? Who is Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal? Why do we need the madhabs? No, we only follow the Quran. Yeah, you only follow the Quran if the Quran is on your phone and you follow it as you go. But be careful. Imam Malik, rahimallah, what a pious man, a great man he was. When the governor of Medina was asking to take them to take bay'ah to Khalif al-Mansur to take the pledge of allegiance, what did he do? Imam Malik refused. He says, a fatwa. He said, anything that is done under duress, to ask me to take under duress the khilafat of that, I won't do. What did he do? He found him guilty, and publicly, Imam Malik rahimahullah was flogged. When the Caliph, Khalifa al-Mansur, heard about this, He apologized most profusely to Imam Ali, and he fired the governor. And as a gesture of goodwill, he sent him 3,000 dinars for traveling expenses, and he says, come to me and come sit here in Baghdad. What did Imam Ali say? Oh, your fellow group, I don't need it. No, thank you. I will stay in Madinatul Munawwara by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. How can you leave a place when you have Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in your proximity? Ya Allah. When Harun al-Rashid, famous Khalifa as well, he visited Madinatul Munawwara and he asked the Imam, he says, please come to my home and give some fantastic lectures and the ilm that Allah has given you. What does Imam Ali say? He says, rather come to my classes where my other students are. And this is a lesson. Go seek knowledge. Yeah, today you find homeschooling now, online, and everything has become easy. But the sunnah way is to go and seek the knowledge. Especially for our children. You won't believe the amount of phone calls I am getting nowadays because of the extramural activities, because of the different types of extra classes that's going on. Can't we reduce a madrasa to once a week? Or can we make it on a Saturday? I said, no, Saturday they need to play. What about Sunday? I said, no, Sunday God rests. What we're trying to say, my dear brothers and sisters and elders, don't spoil our children now, at this level already. Eh? You rather want them to play cricket and soccer at the expense of madrasa? Please, man. Or ballet? This is what scares me today, man. Wallahi, it scares me. And I've got a new lot of students today for the start of this term. Wallahi, they are 14 years old, 15 years old, 13 and 12. Can I tell you, they don't know how to make ghusl. They don't know the dua after wudu, but they have been to madrasa. And this is frightening. And they got fantastic syllabus. I'm not going to mention the names of the madrasa. Fantastic syllabus. It's not to do about syllabi. It's about who you go learn under. This is so important. Ya Allah. The issues that are facing us today are enormous. And the ulama have to address them. So important. They have to. If they do not have the knowledge, go seek the knowledge to address them. You know, I am a firm believer that ulama should have extra classes. You know, the professional doctors or lawyers and things. You, dentists, you've got to go to evening lectures in order to get certain amount of points in order for you to practice your profession that you're in. I firmly believe we should be starting that when it comes to ulama. Wallahi. Fortunately to say, I am beyond that. You know why I'm saying that? I've never ever considered myself as an alim. I will always be a student. Why? Because I want to fall under the hadith which our Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, مَنْ سَلَقَ تَرِيقًا يَلْتَمِسُ فِيهِ عِلْمًا سَهَّلَ اللَّهُ لَهُ تَرِيقًا إِلَى الْجَنَّةِ. And I say to you, my dear brothers and elders, that you should subscribe to the same principle. Always be a student, then you will fall under this hadith. Whoever follows a path in pursuit of knowledge, Allah will make easy for him a path to paradise. And what else? وَإِنَّ الْمَلَائِكَةَ لَتَضَعُ أَجْنِحَتَهَا رِدًا لِطَالِبِ الْعِلْمِ. The angels will lower their wings in happiness, in approval of the one who is seeking knowledge. وَإِنْ طَالِبِ الْعِلْمِ يَسْتَغْفِرُ لَهُ مَنْ فِي السَّمَاءِ وَالْأَرْضِ. And everyone in the heavens and on earth prays for forgiveness for the seeker of knowledge. حَتَّى الْحِيْتَانِ فِي الْمَاءِ. Until even the fish in the sea will pray for you. That's unbelievable. And I'm saying this with due respect to those ulama that have spent years and years overseas or locally, and given blood and sweat for them. But I'm speaking about those ulama who deserve what I am speaking about. May Allah open up your eyes and your hearts and be careful of the amanah that Allah has placed upon you. Because knowledge basically humbles you, isn't it so? You're supposed to be humble. Shaitan was arrogant. He knew all the knowledge. But he didn't know humility. You know, it reminds me of the story. Great Sheikh. Many, many centuries ago, he wanted to cross the river and he hires a boat person to take him across. So the Sheikh told him, Salaamu alaykum, kayful hal. Alhamdulillah, Sheikh. The boatman, poor, he's overawed. His mother, he just rows the boat. Be Sheikh has come. Put the man there, he gets dula, man, you know, diarrhea. So, as he steps into the boat, the Sheikh says, my dear friend, have you studied grammar, nahu, sarf, and so forth? He says, Sheikh, I'm a poor man. I'm just struggling to survive. So the Sheikh says, look at the arrogance. The Sheikh says, half your life is now wasted and gone down the drain. Look at the arrogance. It so happened, this is how Allah plays games with us. Be careful. Be very careful. It so happens the sea suddenly becomes choppy. And they go in towards a tidal pool, you know, the whirlpools and so forth. So the boatman says, Fadila Sheikh, are you able to swim? The Sheikh says, my brother that speaks so eloquently, my Buddha, my friend, my chomi, I can't swim. He says, Fadila Sheikh, not half your life, but your whole life is going out down the drain. So be very careful. Be very careful about ilm. Have humility. Especially, you know, like they also say, you can't cast pearls before swine. Yes, there is a certain level that we have to communicate to certain people. I mean, I can't speak my high level of English to you now. And I'll give it now, so you can translate it for me. You know, I always say this piece of statement. The subsequent relinquishment of the ineptitude thereof is directly proportional to the dichotomy thereof. Now, save me what I mean. For equity. What I'm trying to say is, be humble. Knowledge makes one more humble. Our time is up. May Allah in His infinite mercy always makes us students of learning. Because wallahi, wa fawqa kulli dhi ilmin alim, says Allah in the Quran. That above the one who knows, there's always somebody who knows more than that. Isn't it so? How can we know everything? We can't. Of course not. May Allah protect us, protect our children. Alhamdulillah.